Good morning and welcome to Northside Online for this Sunday, May 3rd, 2020, our first Sunday of May in 2020. Hope everyone is staying safe and doing well. A couple of announcements for you as we begin this morning. Please make sure you continue to check your bulletin. Chris gets all of the tidbits and information in there, but some announcements we want to share with you this morning. First of all, Maya, that is Mitch and Sarah Carey's daughter, suffered an accident involving a candle and received some second and third degree burns. She's been transferred to McLean's Children's Hospital where they'll have a cleaning today. She should be home late this afternoon. So please keep Mitch, Sarah, Maya, and Danilyn, everyone in your prayers in that regard. Also continue to pray for Sheila Havard. She's continuing to have some health problems. Please keep her in mind. Also, we had mentioned before, Danny Mahalik's aunt, Dorothy Grimella, was having some severe health issues. She did pass away, so please keep all the Mahalik's in mind, the passing of Aunt Dot. And then also please keep in mind Doris Dickerson. She took a fall the other day, hit her head, had to have some stitches, but she is home now and resting, but please keep her in mind as well. If you have others, prayer requests, items of note that need to be included in our announcements or in the bulletin, please make sure that you get those to Chris Wheat is the easiest way, or post them in the Facebook group so that we all can have those, and we'll make sure that our prayer warriors continue to get out and do what they do best. But as we continue to move through our service this morning, we appreciate everyone, appreciate all the comments on getting the services out. We'll continue to do this for the intermediate time being. If you didn't see the statement put out by the leadership, please make sure that you check the Facebook group, and that'll talk about the fact that we will continue doing remote services for the immediate future, but we will keep you updated as those things change. So let's continue to worship together, and everyone have a great day.
Sunny slope and plain. since Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precept and promise, awe and love combining, till night shall vanish in eternal day. Give me the Bible when my heart is broken, when sin and grief have filled my soul with fear. Give me the precious words by Jesus spoken. Hold a face lamp to show my Savior near. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precept and promise, law and love combining, till night shall vanish in eternal day. Give me the Bible, lamp of life immortal. Hold up that splendor by the open. Show me the light from heaven's shining portal. Show me the glory gilding Jordan's way. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precept and promise, law and love combined.
Dear Lord, thank you for letting us come here together, even if it's not the way we're particularly used to. And let us be able to continue to worship today through singing, prayer, and listening and reading your word. And just let us to continue to be healthy in mind and in spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art.
But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we come before you today, mindful of the sacrifice that has been made, we are so thankful for your love, for the love of your Son, that he would come down to die in our stead. As we partake of this bread this morning that represents his broken body, we thank you for that love and that sacrifice. In your Son, named Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Father in heaven, we continue our prayer to you today, thankful for your grace, your mercy, your love. We thank you, Father, that you did make us alive in Christ, and we're reminded of that this morning, especially as we think of the life-giving blood that was shed on our behalf. We pray today, Father, that blood, as we drink of this fruit of the vine, will truly breathe back into us new spiritual life, that we will be revived and ready to serve you. We pray it in Christ, and amen.
Made clean by Jesus. Jesus now. We are standing in his presence. We are standing in his presence. We are standing in his presence on holy
All right, can you hear me okay? Am I on? Okay. Good morning, everybody. We are glad that you are joining us, hopefully online this morning, and you're able to see and hear the video well. We know this has been a process, a learning process for all of us, finding ways and finding new ways and trying ways that don't work and then finding ways that do work to make this possible for us to connect with each other online in particular. Thank you for bearing with us in that process, and thank you for being willing to participate. And as Chris said earlier, thank you for the pats on the back. We appreciate that. It has been a challenge, but it has also been, I think, a tremendous blessing. And I hope and I pray, I've been discussing this with people for weeks now, that a spiritual revival occurs through this whole health crisis, because so many people have been telling me that they have been in the Word more. They've been online. They've been able to watch videos. There's more content being put out. There are speakers that you can't normally access who are putting their stuff on video, and you can see and hear and listen to some of the things that they have to say, and it's just a tremendous blessing to be able to connect in those ways right now. So let's take full advantage of it. Let's keep this up, and let's keep going. Also, we're going to keep going in the book of Proverbs today. We're in chapter 30, Proverbs 30. We're going to study the whole chapter this morning. It won't take us very long. If you have with you your YouVersion app, I hope that you'll open that up, the Bible app, and you can find Northside Church of Christ in the event section of the app, and you can follow along with our outline there with the scriptures intact. The truth that we need to start with today before we even start reading the chapter is this. The way that the world really, truly works can only be perceived and understood through a lens, and that lens is God's Son, Jesus Christ. Everything that we do should be filtered through that lens, and it's a lens that we have been calling wisdom. Proverbs indicates that wisdom is the way that the world works. Truly works, not the way that we think it works according to worldly wisdom, but according to God's wisdom, because it's God's wisdom that designed and created the world and brought it into being, and it's Jesus whose wisdom still upholds it even today. So let's look now at just the first nine verses of this chapter. And again, this is the reason I titled this the Proverbs Code with a question mark there is because sometimes we get ourselves a little confused about numbers in the Bible. And we get very excited about seeing numbers, and we think we see certain patterns and things like that. And there may be some places where that's the case. Here in the book of Proverbs, in this chapter in particular, some numbers are going to be thrown out. But I want you to know that once again, that has to do with Hebrew poetry. That has more to do with a poetic device that the author is using to accentuate particular points. And we'll get to that near the end of the chapter. But the real key or the code to Proverbs, as I said, is to see things through the lens of Jesus Christ. So even these first nine verses, please try to be thinking about Jesus Christ as we read through them, because really what we're trying to get across here in these first nine verses is that we need to look to Christ for wisdom, or look through Christ for the wisdom that we need. So here is chapter 30, verse 1. It says, "The words of Agur, son of Jakeh, or Jakeh, the oracle. The man declares, 'I am weary, O God. I am weary, O God, and worn out. Is that how you feel right now? I feel weary and worn out. He says in verse 2, surely I am too stupid to be a man. I have not the understanding of a man. I have not learned wisdom, nor have I knowledge of the Holy One who has ascended to heaven and come down, who has gathered the wind in his fists, who has wrapped up the waters in a garment, who has established all the ends of the earth. What is his name? What is his son's name? Surely you know. Every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. Two things I ask of you. Deny them not to me before I die. Remove far from me falsehood and lying. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food that is needful for me, lest I be full and deny you and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and profane the name of my God. Powerful words here in the book of Proverbs. As we think about these verses, notice that all of this once again begins with a recognition and a need for humility. In order for me to look to Christ for wisdom, I have to consider the real truth that I know nothing. I can't learn anything until I know nothing. If you have ever tried to do any kind of home repair, or maybe you have consulted with an artist to do something for your business, or maybe you have tried to connect with someone via technology and you needed to call somebody like Chris to help you connect and figure out the technology, what you're doing there is you are consulting a skillful person. And really the word for wisdom here in the book of Proverbs is a skill word. It's a word for craftsmen. It's a word for tradesmen and people who have developed their skills. And so what you have to do in those situations is admit that I know nothing about this, and then I need to seek someone who knows enough about this. And for us in Scripture, in particular for wisdom, we have to admit, I know nothing, and only the fear of the Holy One, the knowledge of the Holy One, can help me in this. I know nothing. I don't understand enough to really truly be the kind of person I need to be. So let me go to the source, the one who has the wind in his fist, who has wrapped up the waters, who has established the ends of the earth, the one whose son has a special name. Well, who's that talking about? It's got to be Jesus. And this name is to bring glory. This name is to contain glory, and we are to bring glory to that name. And how do we do that? Well, the Proverbs writer suggests there in verses 5 down through about verse 9. First, we have to consult the Word of God. It is truly something that we have to live by. The source of all wisdom is God. And so we said last week, James chapter 1 and verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, because he gives generously to all without reproach. And what do we ask him for? Well, here in these verses, he says, remove far from me falsehood and lying. In other words, take out the hypocrisy, take out the deception from my tendencies and from my heart, so that I can, again, receive from God what I need to know. And once I do that, then I can see Christ as who he truly is. It's interesting, in John chapter 3, when Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, one of the things he talks about there, it's chapter 3 of John, verse 13. He says, no one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. So how are we going to connect with God? Well, we connect with God through Jesus. He's the Son of Man. He's the one who has been up there and come down here. So whatever he says, we live by what he says. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, one of the things that Moses tells the Israelites about their struggle, their 40 years wandering, is that was there to humble them so that they would become dependent on him. And so they receive the manna, the bread. And then he says, but man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So again, verse 5 of Proverbs 30, every word of God proves true. And so he says, these two things I ask of you. Okay, get the falsehood far from me. And I'm only going to ask you for really, it's the same thing, but I ask it in two ways. Number one, keep poverty far from me. Why? So I can learn to be dependent on you. right? He says in verse 8, give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food that is needful for me. Give me this day my daily bread, right? Luke 11 and Matthew chapter 6. Lest I be full and deny you. And I forget who you are. You know, if I don't have just the right amount, or if I have too much, then I become dependent on me. If I have too little, then I become dependent on stealing or getting what I need from unhealthy ways or immoral ways. And so that's what we need to be careful about right now. So if we want wisdom and how to live skillfully in the world, the way that wisdom shows us it works, the way that God designed it, we have to look to Christ in order to attain that wisdom. Now, in verses 10 through 14, a little sort of sandwiched section between that first part about Christ's wisdom and the glory that it brings to God, and then the last few verses talks about these different numbers. And so let's look at 10 through 14. It says, do not slander a servant to his master, lest he curse you and you be held guilty. There are those who curse their fathers and those who do not bless their mothers. There are those who are clean in their own eyes but are not washed of their filth. There are those, how lofty are their eyes, how high their eyelids lift. There are those whose teeth are swords, whose fangs are knives, to devour the poor from off the earth, the needy from among mankind. Again, I know it may seem like you need like a code-breaking key for all of this, but really what we're looking for here is salvation. Salvation from judgment, salvation from our sins, salvation from the trouble that is deserved, that should come upon us, the problems that should come our way, that Christ, again, saves us from. So we look to Christ not only for wisdom, but also for salvation. He describes in these verses four generations or four groups, depending on your translation there. It just says those in the English Standard Version, but that's what it is. It's the generations or the curses or the groups, I should say. And here are the groups. There's a group that does cursing and not blessing. You don't want to be part of this group, right? The cursing and not blessing group. They don't honor their families. They don't honor their fathers and mothers. They don't follow the trend that Jesus set in Luke chapter 2, verses 51 and 52, where he chooses to go home and submit to his parents and follow their will. And then in John 19, when he's on the cross, he sets up a caretaking situation for his mother. You know, so he took care of his family. He honored his father and mother, very much in contrast to this generation who curse and do not bless their family, their parents. Then there's a generation that are pure in their own eyes, but they're actually unwashed. They're walking around in dirty, soiled, filthy garments. And so there's this need for us, once again, to admit our need for cleansing before we can be cleansed. Cleansing in the spiritual sense is always a passive thing. When we are baptized into Christ, we do that passively. It's something done to us, for us, by God, and by the person who baptizes us. So it is dangerous to walk around with that arrogant idea that I am clean, but not see my own filth, it's the brother with the plank in his eye who doesn't see that plank and tries to help his other brother. Judge not lest ye be judged. So that's the situation there. We want to be caught in that situation as either Jesus had a clear picture of who people are and who he was and the need for cleansing. The next generation is those who are lofty in their eyes, how high they lift their eyes. In the Proverbs, your eyes are always the indicator of your attitude. And if your attitude is raised to where your eyes are looking up and no longer looking down, then you basically are looking down on everybody else. You're arrogant, you're prideful. And Jesus is the opposite of that. Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death on the cross. And then the final generation says they are the ones with teeth like knives or swords or fangs. And they do this devouring, which is a very interesting picture in Scripture. You can look at Revelation 19 and you'll see a picture near the end of time when they come. It says in Revelation 19:17, then I saw an angel standing in the sun with a loud voice. He called to all the birds that fly directly overhead, come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all men, both free and slave, both small and great. And there's this picture of birds in a number of places in Scripture pecking out the eyes of those who do this kind of damage. And so we don't want that. It's a
picture of judgment. It's a picture of pain and suffering because of the curses and the things that we go through. Whatever the situation is, whatever the generation is, the beautiful thing is, if we view this through the lens of Christ, in Galatians 3 and verse 13, it says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. Jesus died on the cross to take away those things and to give us salvation. We have to see all of that through Christ, through that lens, through that filter. And then finally, let's keep reading in verse 15 through the end of the chapter, and we'll close this out. This is where we get into the numbers, okay? Verse 15 says, the leech has two daughters, give and give. Three things are never satisfied. Four never say enough. Sheol, the grave, the barren womb, the land never satisfied with water, and the fire that never says enough. And so you see two daughters that are saying give and give more. It's this reckless abandon, this thirst for whatever we want. It's a greed. It's a desire for whatever I need. Or I think I need, and it's described as the grave or the barren womb or the land or fire. All these things are consuming things that never reach having enough. And so these are appetite warnings. What is my appetite? What is it that I want? And he goes on to explain some of that. Verse 17, the eye that mocks a father and scorns to obey a mother will be picked out by the ravens of the valley and eaten by the vultures. There again is the picture of this being eaten up and devoured, in particular by the birds. Again, Revelation 19. And so, again, I'm going to read 18 and following, but you see, again, this same pattern. Three and then four. And the way that this poetic device works is the three are not nearly as important as the fourth. They're all analogies, they're all helpful, but that fourth one is the key that he's trying to emphasize. So in verse 18 he says, three things are too wonderful for me. Four I do not understand. The way of an eagle in the sky, the way of a serpent on a rock, the way of a ship on the high seas, and the way of a man with a virgin. In each of these situations, you see that there is no trace evidence for the path, for the way that these animals have trod or the ship has come. And in the same way, there's something mysterious about love, about sexual love in particular. And part of the reason we say that is in verse 20, there's a contrast. So in verse 19, the way of a man with a virgin. And then in verse 20, it says, this is the way of an adulteress. And she eats and wipes her mouth and says, I have done no wrong. What appetite are we talking about here? Well, it's a sexual appetite. And so you've got the greed appetite, the money and wealth appetite. You've got this sexual appetite that he's concerned about here. And she thinks, this adulteress thinks, well, there's no evidence. I've hidden it well. I wipe my mouth. Nobody knows what I've done. But the reality is, it's found out. Everybody knows. It is because of God. God knows what you have done. It can't be hidden. Proverbs 5:21, nothing is hidden from the Lord's sight. And so we're fooling ourselves when we think that we can allow our appetites to get so out of control. The last one is more of a status and pride thing. Verse 21, it says, under three things the earth trembles. Under four it cannot bear up. A slave, when he becomes a king, and a fool when he is filled with food, an unloved woman when she gets a husband, and a maidservant when she displaces her mistress. You ever come to a position of power too quickly and you don't appreciate? You ever try to eat after a long period of not eating, fasting maybe, and you realize how ravenous your hunger is and your body's just not ready for it? It'll start to reject what you've just eaten because you're not ready to take on this position. It's a status and pride issue that gets out of control. So he warns us about those appetites, and then he gives us some wisdom instructions. So we're in verse 24 now. Four things on the earth are small, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are people not strong, yet they provide their food in the summer. Ooh, ants. The rock badgers are a people not mighty, yet they make their homes in the cliffs. They have these safe dwelling places because they are wise. They know where to be to keep away from danger. Verse 27, the locusts have no king, yet all of them march in rank. They have an order, they have a cooperation, they have a community without having a so-called leader. Then the lizard you can take in your hands, so small, yet is in kings' palaces. Even though he's small, he has access to these wonderful, powerful places. And then he goes on to talk about three stately animals in contrast to these small and humble animals. Verse 29, three things are stately in their tread, four are stately in their stride. The lion, we would all expect, right? Which is mightiest among beasts and does not turn back before any. The strutting rooster, right? He's full of himself. He's quite powerful in his own mind. And then the he-goat or the ram. And a king whose army is with him. Again, the three and then the fourth, the emphasis on that king who believes that his army is with him. So we need, again, to think about how we need to start with the wisdom. Start with the humility to understand where we belong. And I liken this final section to the need for us to look at the world through the lens of Christ, or through the filter of Christ. Every time somebody takes a picture now and posts it on Instagram or Facebook, they get a chance to scroll through the filters to make themselves look a particular way. And I'm not suggesting any moral issue there. I'm just suggesting that we tend to want to filter through things. When we do that, spiritually, we need to filter things through the line of Christ. It's interesting in the life of Joseph, where you get to see his humble beginnings being brought low because of his imprisonment, his being hurt by his brothers, and then God slowly but surely exalting him. And the promise that's given to the Lion of Judah later on in the life of Joseph is a promise of exaltation later on down the road. But first, we're that humble one, the ant, the rock badger, you know, we are the small ones until God lifts us up and puts us where we need to be. If we see ourselves through Christ, we see ourselves in humble terms. And then finally, the last two verses, it says in verse 32, if you have been foolish, like all of us, exalting yourself, or if you have been devising evil, put your hand on your mouth. Shut up. Cover up your mouth. Stop doing that. You've got to quit because you're seeing yourself through the wrong filter, through the wrong lens. You're seeing yourself in your own skewed way. It says in verse 33, for pressing milk produces curds. Pressing the nose produces blood. You ever getting socked in the nose and start bleeding? And pressing anger produces strife. So we get to look at this world the way that God has designed it, even the animals, and see the way that God has designed it brings about wisdom. And it's wisdom that is clearest, seen clearest through the lens and the filter of Christ. In Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20, it says, he is the image of the invisible God. Who? Christ. The firstborn of all creation. Who's that? Christ. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. Who's this? Christ. And he is before all things. And in him all things hold together. Who's this? Christ. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. He might be on top. Who's that? Christ. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. God was happy to come down and dwell in Jesus in that special way, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. You need the cross, you need Jesus on the cross in order to see yourself in the proper filter and light and lens. My friends, this morning, if you need something, if we can help you in some way, contact us. We love you, we're praying for you, and we hope to see you before long.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away, fly away, fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, fly away, fly away. I'll fly away, fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away, fly away, fly away. Just a few more.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you so grateful for this time to gather together, to sing songs of praise to your name, to study a portion of your word. Lord, we know that there are many throughout the country and the world that are hurting, that are sick, that are dealing with this newest disease, Lord, and dealing with so many others. We know that folks are dealing with economic stresses as well as health stresses. There are just so many things going on in the world that bottom line, Lord, that they can start to focus on instead of focusing on you. Lord, we pray that they would continue to look to you, to look to your word for guidance, for leadership. We pray for those folks in positions of leadership in our country and throughout the world that they would continue to make the best decisions possible, that they would look to you to guide them as they make those decisions. We pray as we continue to work in our own lives that, again, that we would look to you for guidance as we make decisions for our homes and our families. Lord, we look so forward to the days that we'll be able to gather together again as congregations across this world. But more importantly, Lord, we pray that we would continue to look forward to the day that we will all gather with you someday in heaven, that we would continue to live our lives in the way that you would have us lead them, that we would do our best to follow your commandments. We know that we do not deserve the grace you bestowed upon us, but we hope to do what you've asked us so that we can receive that gift, that we can be with you someday in heaven. Pray that you would look after all those that we've mentioned that are ill, that are grieving, and continue to forgive us of our sins as we continue to love you as you have loved us. All these things we pray in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.